Hey friend, sorry about that. I tried to stream a little bit earlier, but I am positive that I was using the wireless network, which doesn't give me the throughput that the wired network does. So I have restarted the stream with apologies. I'll go delete the older ones, and I'm recording this, so I'll be putting this posting this. Stephen Ray Leonard, this is my son, and I'm going to go ahead and fire up the other network now that I know. I'll turn the wireless back on. Now that I know I am on the good network, and I can tell this because there's an awful lot of little green box down here and in the bottom here where there just wasn't earlier. So I apologize again, but let's see. Let's look at the stats here. And yeah, we're looking better than we were. Okay. So that said, on both YouTube and Twitch to see if this is doing better. And I really hope and believe that it will now that I've changed my networks up. All right. If you were on the earlier stream and dumped off, I apologize. But this is Stevie's blog here, Stevie Ray Leonard. And his first post is about the modern backyard greenhouse, and we're looking at IoT, and he's describing here the setup that we've got. We've got an Arduino, kind of a microcontroller board here, an Arduino Pro Mini. We've also got we got a bag of these, by the way. I think we got five or six for under $20, and we got about the same deal on Picos. I want to say we got five of those for under $20 as well. And we're looking at the Raspberry Picos and playing around with this. And we're combining a Raspberry Pi. This is a three. He did this work, and he tells you all about it here. He did the work on a four, and then he updated it by rolling back to the three so he could get the four back for R&D. But lots of good stuff in here that he's doing. There's a clock in here, a real-time clock. And the reason that he's got code in here for that stuff he found online is we want to synchronize this and the Andy Weather instruments. So the Andy Weather instruments, I brought those up. They haven't read anything since yesterday evening. We're recording on the 3rd of October, 2021. And again, if you get experience delays here and bad things happening with the frame rate, go ahead and just make sure you look at this on my blog. I'll post a video shortly after we finish this recording here. All right. So yeah, there's Stevie's code and then Andy Weather, and we're starting to collect information from inside of the greenhouse. And I wrote this little application here, actually with Stevie's help. So we've got an IP there for it, and we're going to connect to this and see if we can start reading data. And we can. Of course, we're getting a little Unicode percent, or sorry, degree symbol there. It's giving us the Unicode null character. But yeah, it's nice what we're doing here and collecting this data. The next piece is to parse this data, and I figured I'd work on that with you right here together. So we're collecting these a line at a time, and I'd like to do a couple of things. The first thing is I want to persist this data locally, this stream. So I'm going to send it out to a file, and I'm going to write it locally to a file first, and I'm probably going to then after that persisted to a database. So here we are doing the end execute and storing the result here. After we do that, I want to definitely write this out to a file. So I'm going to see if I can do this. Now, one of the interesting parts of this is we're in kind of an asynchronous call to this run command. And so we're going to run into some issues when we try and do this. And you could see here this new task logic here. This is, I said asynchronous. I'm not sure if that's the right word to use or not. But what I'd like to do is, I think I'm going to do it inside of this run command window, because one of the things I noticed earlier, even in here, is when I was trying to write to text.status.text, is it wasn't really playing well with me. It wasn't playing nice. And the reason was it wasn't created within the available, it wasn't created within this method here. So if I run this now, we'll see an error probably once I connect. We'll see an error pop up right there. And yeah, it's telling me a cross-threaded. So I don't know if that's asynchronous or not. Cross-threaded operation not valid. The control text status, let me zoom in here so you can read it with me, is accessed from a thread other than the thread it was created on. So probably asynchronous wasn't the right term. Multi-threaded, or you know, that may be a better term to think about with it. And it's given me some code here. You know, it's letting me know that it's being accessed from a thread other than the thread it was created on. I could probably pick that error up and go see what I can learn about it. My favorite place to go look for exceptions information is, here we go, access from a thread other than the thread it was created on there. I'll just pick this up, pop over to my favorite search engine. I like DuckDuckGo for privacy concerns. And by the way, if you're interested, you can follow. I have a bunch of information on the following stuff here. It looks like Twitch is saying my player needed to be reloaded. Hopefully there's enough going there to where you can see it. I'm trying to be live. I am, but I believe that I am not being live. So let me pop off of here. Let me stop watching. Maybe that'll help. And we'll see if that encourages things to play nicer. Cross-threaded app not, you know, not valid. That looks like a good one. Let's go look at that one, that Stack Overflow, and see what information I can find here. And I find usually good information at Stack Overflow. Sometimes it's hit or miss, but yeah, let's see. Ran into this text box, control called blah blah blah, extract. That's exactly the error, executed or accessed from a thread other than one it was created on. And let's see, some more links here. And they shared their code, which is always a complaint. Try da 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 da. Okay, rather than doing that, try that. Okay, let's try that. We'll go ahead and pause here. And we're kind of doing exactly what they're showing in there. Let's go ahead and do this. And we want to do text status instead of stacks status. And let's see if that works. And we'll go ahead and try running this again. And I like doing these things where I'm kind of troubleshooting right here in front of you. I learned this way watching others, and if you learn this way, awesome. It looks like it is working. You can see it's giving me my text message. That's what I wanted. So that problem is solved. Now let's go ahead and stop this. And what I'd really like to be able to do is some more of these comments. Da-da-da-da-da. Let's see. Yeah, actually some more text. And let's see if we can do a little string.format here. How about that? For your viewing pleasure. Connected to, we'll make this a little CE. And do it this way. I like doing it that way. All right, so there we are, and then I can kind of put a comment out here beside this. That's where zero is. Username is the :1. I'm not going to put the password in there, and then down here I can put the command as 2. How's that? So this will be, let's go ahead and make this as, there we go. username. That'll be one, and then that's two. So that'll be nice. It'll kind of, if it does what I want it to do, it'll pop up that information every time. So let's do connect here. And yep, it's telling me the command I'm executing there, which you can see it up here as well. One of the differences in the Pi 3 and Pi 4 is, I think this was ACM 0 in the Pi 4, and in the Pi 3, it is USB 0. All right, that's good. Let's see about storing this. So I'm wondering how I would do the kind of the writing piece of this. So after I'm done with this, let me kind of look through where I am with that. What am I doing here? This is my using var. Where's my line? Because that's what I'd like to. That's what I'd like to deal with. And this is, I thought I had fixed the Unicode 63 with a degree. Wondering cam now. And here's that same kind of method. Look at that. Text box invoke. So I kind of knew already that I needed to do something different than what I was doing. Okay, let's pause here and see what that line is showing me. Go ahead and connect. And what does line have in it? Okay, that's the first line. The second line, there's my temperature. Let's copy that value and go ahead and stop our execution. Let's see if we can view the hex. Yeah, this is how I figured it out to start with. What is that value right there? And sets. And there's a way to see, I think there's a way to see the ASCII to hex, maybe? Yeah, that's what I got right there. EFBFBD. And that's what I have up here. EFBFED, and somewhere out of this I was able to get the number 63. Line replace, now replace Unicode. So if that line is really that dash 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 dash, so that's 6, 7, 8, 9, 10, 11, 12, 13, 14, 15, 16, 17, 18, 19, 20, 21, 22, 23, 24, 25, 26, 27. Let's see if we can look at character 27 here and say, if line.length greater than 27, then we'll make it 28 for good measure. String car equals line.substring. Line, that's our start index is 0, our length, that's not right, our start index is 27, I think, maybe 26, and our length is 1. Oh, I can't do string car. Okay, how about ch? There we go. All right, so I'm going to stop here now. Yeah, let's try that now and see what that does. All right, let's look at that watch. See what that came out with. It's a space. Well, darn. All right, we'll stop there again. Let's do 26. There's 26. Also, oh, it's a T. All right. What would that be? T. Oh, okay. It's a different line. Interesting. Okay, here's one. All right, C. All right, let's try back up one more. 25. Let's go again to that one of those lines there. It's okay. I kind of knew that. All right. So what if I say int a equals, how do I convert to ASCII? I think it's just int of the character. I think that'll do it. Can I go back there? No, I cannot. Sorry, int character. Let's try it now. Can I go back? Also, no. What's your problem? Cannot convert int to string. I thought there was a way to do that. Okay, let's go look it up. Hey, there we go. Unicode int. Let's see what we find there. Not yet. Another Stack Overflow. And let's see what our... Interesting. Get numeric value. All right, this shows dot select that get numeric value. Let's try that. It's not there. What about that whole dot select thing? C dot. No, it's not showing up. Not letting me get in there. Okay, let's try this entire thing here. So we'll do int a equals 0. Try parsing string dot select. Is that valid? Then inside the if then, we will say, I'm just going to put a dummy line in here to something to stop on. If it succeeds in trying to parse that, see if that works. Doesn't like it. Edits were made which cannot even bound. Fine. We'll stop and restart. How's that? Build and see. One failed. Really? Okay. Build again. Forgot a curly brace. Let's try this again. Look at our watches there. Okay, where's a negative one? So it's definitely finding the null character. Some of the time. It's giving me -1. Is that valid? What if I adjust this then? Let's do this. Replace it equals -1. We'll start there and make a note that it was 63. Go again. It didn't replace that. So see, it didn't, this didn't work. The character is equal to that. Let me copy the value then. Why aren't you liking me? Oh, because that's not a car. That's a car. See if that works. Let's stop here next. Doesn't look like it's not working. That's the one we want to update. Woot! It worked. You see that? I saw that. I've got my degree symbol in there. You know, and this probably is different because the last time I had this working, it was using the 63 character there, the 63 Unicode value to replace it, and it was working. Interesting how it's different for a different, maybe it's a different. Pies is doing it. I'm not sure. But let's see if we run this, what we get in our application. And I can see kind of zooming in here that it's, well, I don't see my degrees here. Now I do. There they are. Even if it wasn't doing it earlier. Yeah, that's very odd. It's like it's replaced the whole thing. Okay. We have degree symbols. At least there. We don't have them up here, but that is okay. All right, let's see if we can log. We can write. So the question becomes, how do I write? I'm going to start. I think I'm going to start in here because, yeah. Now, there's about 100% chance this is going to blow up. So, I'm going to start with just a system.io file. And I'm going to create my own file. Let's see, I want to find my user directory. Let's see if that works. See if we can do the log to text here. So there's our user directory. And I'm going to set this to that. And yeah, I'm just going to put a... So I've got a breakpoint. And my user path, that looks like me. Add that watch. Okay, I think I'm done with that and that. All right, fair enough. Let's stop. And then I want to create a file if it doesn't exist. So if io.file, make a, this is going to be not, and we're going to make a file name here. I'm just going to stub this in. And yes, I know file name doesn't exist yet. String file name is going to equal string date string is going to equal now date and time, date time, not date and time, date time dot now. Let's try to string, see what we get there. File name is going to equal Stevie Weather 1 plus the date string. I'm going to say if that file does not exist. Actually, no, if it does exist. If it does not exist, I guess we're going to create it. I don't know. I don't know if we need that. Let's just say we want to write to that now and... io.file. Yes, file name dot, no, maybe. Maybe it's right, my append all lines. I think I like that better. Append all lines, and then I need the path. Yeah, I picked the winner. And then I need the contents. What else can I do here? Encoding. Normal string appends lines to a file. I think I just want something else. Maybe append all text. Let's try that. Maybe. All right. Builds. Let's see what that does. Blew up. The exception was originally thrown. The given path's format is not. Okay. What is the given path? Oh, yeah. That is not supported. All right. Let's change that. Let's see if there's another way to do dot now.
Right. Intended. Let's try that. And let's just try to get through there. Weird. Not what we want. I mean, that would work. We also want to make this let's go ahead and make it a text file, shall we? All right, we don't want that one. That we learned. Let's see what that does. Yeah, that's what got us in trouble last time. Go back to that. Do a little editing on the fly. What if we just look at now? Let's see what that does. Yeah, also bad. What if we... There might be a way to do that. Let's take a look at dates and now and see if there's a kind of an easier way. It doesn't look like it. What about daytime? Is there... No, now's our dude. Short date string, short time string, short date string. All right. Wonder if there's a... Here. Okay, what if I did a replace here, and I said replace the dashes there, I mean the slashes, with a dash, and then replace I think there's a way to regex that. Like AM/PM. See what that does. Interesting. Knowing the colons are going to be bad too, aren't they? Replace colon with another dash, I guess. Ugly. but it works. Let's see if this will do the thing. All right, now it's time to go see if it's... Let's go find that file. It's changing the file name every time. Okay, that's bad. Let's see if it worked. Documents. Is that where it went? No, I think it went to my user's file. See users me. I don't see it. Okay, let's do this. Take this out. Put these up top. Like here. Yeah. Let me do that. It's got to be an, it's an initializer. Okay. Where's my file name? That is not correct. And I want that path in there, user path. Let's do this. If user path, if not user path, ends with user path. This vehicle. There we go. There. Okay, there's our file name. Let's see. See users A. Ray Leonard. Step over that. Is there a new file? There's a new file. Weed, look. It recorded it. Okay. Let's keep going. That's it. Let's go. This is growing. See that? We're up to 2K. Still collecting data. I think that's more than 2K. Let's stop. See what we got. Cool. That's great. We are collecting data. So let's continue. Let's look at parsing this data. Let this run in the background. We'll use this file as a good test.
Let that continue to log data. By the way, the name of the application is like something like Windows Forms App 1, but it will be renamed here. This is the name of the alien protector at the beginning of the Larry Niven novel protector. So I don't know how to pronounce that. Fish Hawk? I don't know. But yeah, that's why we named him. Both Stephen and I are Larry Niven fans. We don't want to get sued, but it's a great book. Instead, we'll just rename it if there's an issue. How's that? Okay, so we are, I believe, that's not the right form thing there. If I'm not mistaken, we're collecting data into another file. There it is. And that gives us some time to tinker around with this one. We need to parse this file, and I want to load it into a database. So before that, I've got, this is VWS here is actually running on a, it's running on a network. And the network, it's actually a domain, a little domain here that I built. And VDB is the database. VWS is the workstation. VDB is the database. They're all running on, I mentioned, I thought this was the problem in the first stream attempt. I'm still getting too many dropout errors, so I don't know. You can watch the video and get more information. But yeah, this is the database server. I'm going to try and fire this up and see if we're copacetic. All Hyper-V. And I think, let me try connecting to it from VWS. I've got SSMS on here. These are very small VMs. I think these, the workstation and the database are assigned two CPUs, two logical processors.
Excuse me.
And the domain controller's only got one and like 4 gigs of RAM, maybe 8 gigs. Workstation and DB both have 8 gigs of RAM. Hey, we're up to 5K. That's a lot of daters. Okay. Didn't mean to click that. I'm starting a new instance. Not what I wanted. I only wanted to have the one instance. And we'll close this and stop the other instance, maybe. Yeah, there they both come. Okay, this one, no. This one, yes. So we want to go to VDB SSIS dev. See if we can reach it. And I may have made a change that broke that. And if I did, I'll just go over to the database server and build this. I think I can do that. Let me see. Maybe not. Yeah, a network error. The server was not found. Okay, accessible. Okay. What was this? What is that? I don't know where that is. VSQL 19. Is that another VM? Let's see. Actually, it is. But it's not on this network. I don't think. Did I just... I think I may have just built that one as well. Fire that one up. Yeah, I did put it on this network. Maybe not.
Yeah, we are on this number. All right. Let's see if we can talk to it. We can. That's really odd. Okay, so something's misconfigured on VDB, and I will troubleshoot that at another time. But right now, I'm going to take you out of my RAM. Get out of my RAM. Okay, so our database, we're going to make a new database here. I don't think I've got Zoom running on here, but I can check. Okay, excelente. Okay. And I'm going to do a quick So I do this every time. While I like to see commands completed successfully, it doesn't tell me which commands completed successfully. And this kind of bugs my OCD, which is, sorry, CDO, which is OCD with the letters in their proper order. Do a quick check of that. And let's save it. And run it. So I created it. Let's rerun it. Plus it's idempotent SQL, re-executable SQL. We refresh and we should see a Stephen Weather database. That is outstanding. All right, next. It's a little bit different. We're going to now go after the schema. Come back to that. This we have to do a little bit different. schema, creating schemas, creating procs have to be in their own little world, their own transaction. Zoom out, see what that does. The checker likes it. When we ran it, we see the database exists and the stage schema exists. And if we go down into security and look at schemas. Hello, I'm streaming. What's up? Okay. All right. There we are. There's our stage schema. Okay. Next, we'll create a table for data to go in, but not yet. Not until we're done kind of playing around with this data. So we are still on here. So let's see. I think I've got SSIS installed on here. If we don't, we can do that real quick. Let's see. New project. Integration services project. What we want. And let's put this on our projects folder. And let's call this Load Steven Weather Data. Our 2 gigs of RAM are showing up here. Reload all. So we're headed for a SQL 19 database. I'm going to go ahead and leave this in SSIS and SQL Server 2019. But I just want to let you know that there's bugs in here, and I don't know if they're ever going to get fixed. I know how to work around them. For instance, if for one, we'll start here. We'll take the git changes out as well. The package properties. The package is named package. And if I rename the package here, I don't know how it could have unsaved changes outside of the changes inside the editor's been changed externally. See, that's not accurate, but I use it. I just click yes to all. Go ahead and reload it if that's what you need to do. That's the best you can do. 2019, that's what we'll do. The package is still named package. So I'm going to, I guess, do another change outside of the environment and load Steven Weather, load Steven Weather. Make sure those are identical. Steven Weather. Okay. They are identical. And I want to start by creating a data flow in SSIS. And inside the data flow, I am going to make a flat file source. And right now I'm going to hard code this. Double click this to edit, and I'm going to use the new button over here to create a flat file connection manager. Love this. It creates one and then it opens the editor. I'm going to browse to that file in my users directory for now. And we want the 2 version. Our text is not qualified, so we're going to leave it at that. Delimited. I'm going to say it's delimited, but then I'm not going to give it a delimiter. Let's take a look at the file again. Actually, I'm going to go over here and open it inside of here. Let's open a file. There's our file open in Notepad++, which does a, in my humble opinion, a fair job of delimiting it here. So I do see a pipe. We're gonna have to talk about the file format here. Me and Stevie. But we'll cover that. That's the good news of owning the source and the target. Let's see, where's the good data? What do we want? Well, we definitely want the date and time. We want the temperature and the humidity. Yeah, we'll go get the heat index as well. So I'll tell you what, the way I'm going to approach this load is I'm going to load the data just as it is into a database table, a staging table. When I go to columns here, it's going to tell me, you know, it sees all sorts of columns all over the place. I'm going to change that. The row delimiter, I'm going to leave at CRLF, and I'm going to delete the column delimiter. Now, when I do that and refresh it, it thinks the entire, well, it should think the entire row. It should make a brand new row out of that. That's very interesting. Oh, I see it did. There's this DHTXX test. Is that in here anywhere else? It is not. So back to general, and let's go ahead and skip one header row. Now if we go look at our columns, we can see that it's nothing but our datas, or as we say here in Farmville, Virginia, daters. If I look on advanced, it's going to tell me there's one column. I can rename it, and I will. E column. I just did that. I'm going to make it more than 50 because I suspect it is. Let's go back over here and go to the end of the second column. That looks like one of the longer ones. Yep. And we're at position 1491. Is that right? Length 1649. That's out there. So let's go with 2000. And this is inside of our flat file connection manager, by the way. So if we preview this now, we can see our daters all the way out to 2000 columns here. In general, you know what? I think I'm going to mark it as Unicode. I don't know if I'm storing it as Unicode or not. Let me see what the preview thinks. It thinks I'm not. Maybe because of this data type. Let's change this to Unicode and see if that changes things. Now let's go to preview. Still no love. All right, let's un-Unicode you. I still think I want to go with a Unicode string here. Just because. Okay. Let's click OK. And look at our columns. We should see the column. There's only the one. Click zero. Our source is configured. We're going to go straight to an OLEDB destination. Do not pass go. Do not collect $200. And we're going to say stage Stephen. Weather file. That's going to be the name of it. data. That's going to be the name. All right, so we're going to connect the data flow path, double click. We don't have any OLEDB connection managers. I'm going to create a new one. Let's click on new. Creates a new OLEDB connection manager and opens the data. The data opens the editor. Let's see where we are. Dev. It's a good place to be when you're developing software. I'm going to use Windows Auth. I'm going to hit this list and find Stephen Weather, I hope. I'm going to click test connection, but the truth is when I dropped that down and was able to see a list of the databases, the connection was tested and succeeded. I'm going to go ahead to click OK here and OK again. Name of the table of view. There are no tables of views. We just created the database and we didn't create a table of view. So I'm going to click new here. And it's going to pop up the create table. I'm going to rename this. I'm going to put it in a stage schema. Actually, you know what? I should put this in the raw schema. Yeah, because it's reading from the raw file. I'm going to go with that. Now, this is going to blow up because I don't have a raw schema, but I'm going to go back to, I'm going to do this differently than I show people how to, there's a trick I show people in my courses. First thing I'm going to do, I'm going to put that there. If you're interested in my courses, go to andyleonard.blog. I am going to be delivering in-person courses, live online, not in-person, that's not accurate. Live online and at the end of next month and the beginning of December. It's wrong. There's a coupon code at the top of the blog post that'll save you 33% because the course is not cheap. Doing 2 days on Expert SSIS and 1 day on Introduction to Azure Data Factory. It's a pretty packed day though. Okay, the raw schema was created. I can see it down here. I rerun that. I see it already exists. That's a good test. Now I can create this table either in SSMS here, and I kind of want to do that, but not, let's put it in here. We're going to come back to it. We'll come back and mess with this later. Kind of get started here on it. Hector, this IoT project, and you asked this question a while ago. I'm sorry, I just now looked over. This is the greenhouse. We are collecting data from Leonard Greenhouse Project. You can learn more about the project itself. Let's see. I think I closed. Yeah, I did. I closed the browser. But if you go to my son's blog post on this, StephenRayLeonard.com, um, There it is, Stephen with a PH, RayLeonard.com. His first blog post, I think it's his only one, is a modern backyard greenhouse begins with IoT. And if you click on that, he's describing what he built, and he built this. I just bought him the parts, and this is an Arduino, let's see, the Pro Mini, kind of a microcontroller that's doing the instrumentation, collecting the data from the instruments. It's mounted on a kind of mounted to the breadboard is to a Raspberry Pi 3, and got a few instruments that we're collecting data from. And he goes into a lot. He talks about all the stuff he did here in this. And I think this is going to be the first of like three posts. So the code's in here and everything. Heck, if you want to learn more about what we're doing, I'm really proud of him for writing. And I'm proud of him for figuring it out in the first place. So we're going to be collecting that data here. And yeah, I think I'm going to go ahead and do this here, if that's okay. And if it's not okay, I'm sorry. And Hector, you said cool that I'm working on this. Yeah, I wanted to share a little by Sunday afternoon, kind of finished with my outside work. This is the table. So, I'm going to print. I like my stuff to line up like I like my stuff to line up. Okay, so there's that. This is going to be a null column. I want to be able to capture. I want to give this a fighting chance at capturing the data from the greenhouse. And this is, again, my kind of CDO way of creating these things. I know. Okay, so up here is going to be a begin. Here's going to be an end else, which is going to give me an error because I don't have the if in there yet. Not being close though. And then I need my if. And my if's a little complicated. I'm going to go ahead and bring this down because it's got most of it in it. Let's make this bigger. How's that? Okay, so I like to do this. Scheme raw. Okay, so raw and then the name of the table. And yeah, that's all we're putting in there. And let's go ahead and run this again. And yeah, it looks like it created the table. Let's make sure it's re-executable. Yep, it already exists. So now we're going to be able to populate that table. If I return to SSIS here, I don't need to create the table anymore. I can just scan it again. And when I scan this time, I should see the table. Maybe. Yep, there it is. The other thing is data access mode. This is going to write one row, kind of, it's going to do like an insert into. Table of view fast load is going to do a bulk insert.
want to do the mappings, and there's one column. And if you remember, I clicked the new button on the table and copied the DDL, data definition language, out of there. So this table, and I eventually used that statement, modified a little, to build this table with this column in it. The reason that it did the auto mapping is the destination was actually built from the available input columns here. So that's one cool thing you can do in SSIS. So we should be able to just load this data. And I want to make this a, I want to make this load volatile. What do I mean by that? Well, I want to go ahead and truncate this every time. I'm going to tell this raw. There. So up here, I want to go to favorites and bring over an execute SQL task. I want to pop over here and get the name of the table right here. Back to here, execute SQL task. And just so you know, while we're here and kind of, I've got the browser open, SSIS.tips. I actually maintain this website. This is me. And naming conventions are in here. This is where I get all my naming conventions from, SSIS tips. I keep thinking I should stick an ad up there. I just haven't brought myself to do it yet. What do I want to use here? I definitely want to use this. I want to name this according to my naming convention. SQL truncate raw target. And the connection I want to use is the OLADB connection I made earlier. Paste. So if I look at this, truncate table raw.steven file data, click OK. Put a precedence constraint here. Right click and execute that, just to, kind of like the equivalent of a unit test. The table exists, there's no data in it, truncating it should work. Or not. It's taking a while. There, okay, that worked. Actually, it took a long time. Okay, so let's load that. And the reason I did the truncate first is so I can come over here and do a new query and say select star from what's on the clipboard. And yep, there's my data. So there we are. And again, the key here is I want every row that shows up to show up in here. I'm going to re-execute this and re-execute my query. It's the same thing over again. Maybe if I blow this out as text, it may be a little easier to see. It looks like it is. It's a little big though. See if I can make this smaller without making that smaller. 120% maybe. Wow, okay. Let's see what that does. Wow, odd. I'm typing 120%. It's not working. Okay. Well, that's close. 150, that gives us a nice, decent view of it. So another thing now that I can do in SSIS while I'm here is I can do this data flow inside of a for each loop. So if I go look at a for each loop container, drag it on here, drag this into it, and rename this. I'm just going to leave it named for each, but I'm going to call this for each Steven weather data file. Again, after truncating the target, right? I don't want to truncate it inside the loop because I want to load all of the files. Right now, there's only two in there. So what am I after? Well, I'm going to do a for each file enumerator. And one of the things I'm going to do in my expressions here I'm going to see if I can create a new variable. I don't think I can, not from here. So I need to just go ahead and click OK for now. Let's do a new variable. Variables are not showing. Go up here. They are right there. Make a new variable. It's odd looking. See, that's kind of buggy. And I'm not getting the iBeam telling me that I can move this. I have to just click around and find it. See, that's what variable should have looked like, and now it does. Let's do source file directory. Let's make it a string, three S's. And for now, let's put... put this directory in there. That way I can move the file. Feel me? We'll go ahead and type a backslash at the end of it. And there's the directory. We'll go back into the configuration for the for each loop. And inside of the collection, it's file enumerator. And I am going to pick the expression, I think it's called directory. Yep. And in the expression builder, I'm going to add source file directory, click evaluate expression, and that's where it's going to search. It's going to go search for files in that location managed by that variable. So if I change the value of the variable, if I move the files, and I will, I can look for them elsewhere. The files I'm looking for are, let's see if we can figure out a good naming convention for them. We see this one is named this. So let's grab this file name, the old file name. Let's pop it in here and let's kind of genericize this. We definitely want text. We'll just put an asterisk there. So it's going to go after the fully qualified name. I don't want it to traverse subfolders at this time. I may later. Variable mappings. So for here, I can say a new variable. And I'm going to create this new variable at the load Stephen weather container level. Sometimes that doesn't work. So that's the full file name. It's a string value. And I'm going to click OK. That's all that I'm going to get back from this, is that particular file name. Click OK. I'm going to go back into my data flow now. Really, I don't need to go in my data flow. I need to go to this flat file connection manager. And I'm going to leave that one there, but I'm going to rename this one. So why am I renaming this one and not the other? Because in just a minute, I'm going to promote both of these to, in fact, I'll do this one now. I'm going to promote it to a project connection. And you see it says project and it's all happy. But what happens if I do a promotion here on this one? This is not a 2019 bug. This is a bug in project level connection managers because it'll let me name them in a way by default. In fact, SSIS named that connection manager, that package connection manager, in a way that will not allow it to be promoted to a project level connection manager. So I have to go rename it. And I'm just going to call it Stephen Weather. Now I can promote it. Boom. All right. So that got promoted. And what I want to do with it is I want to go look at the properties. I'm pressing F4 that displays the properties of this. I want to go to expressions here. And one of the expressions for this flat file connection manager, sorry, that's not the flat file connection manager, is it? Let's go to the other one. Flat file connection manager, F4. And now let's check the expressions. Yes. The connection string property is actually the path to the file. and the files look alike. So what I really want to do is I want to name this, I want to rename this path. I want to set the connection string value at runtime. But I did a boo-boo. The only thing it can read here is project parameters. And I can't use the for each loop to go find the files and give me the full path to a parameter. Parameters can't change after the package begins running. They're read-only at that point. So I can reconvert this back to a package and a package level connection manager. And I have to do this little trick I'm doing. Now I can look at connection string. And when I click the editor here, we're going to see something different. We're going to see variables and parameters. And there's my file name. So what's happening here is every time I execute this, go ahead and click OK. I also want to set delay validation on this. It's another property here. Make that true because it won't know the file to start with. So each time, first I truncate the target table. Then I come into this loop and I go look in that directory that's stored in this variable source file directory there. And as I loop through that directory, each time I find a file, I'm going to place that file, a file that matches our kind of our model here, our discrimination, if you will. And what we're looking for is stuff that starts with fishpock underscore Stevie Weather underscore, I should have made that Stephen Weather, my bad, underscore text, or it's something then dot text. So there's a one underscore and some kind of date string in here now. It's going to find two of those right now. And every time it finds one, it's going to push that value, that full path, into this variable here, Stephen Weather file name. And when that happens, then it's going to go into the loop. Each time it's going to run the loop, and it's going to read from that source, right here again, the one that's controlled by that connection manager, which is the value of the connection string is controlled by the for each loop. It's going to read from that file and write into to here. So if we run this, I don't know if this is going to fail because we're still writing to that file. I don't know. That second file. Let's see. Let's run it and see what happens. It's building. I saw it run twice. And if you'll note, it picked up 423 rows, which is more than it picked up from the other one. Now if we do the execute here, we should see our initial rows are in there still, in that first file. Zoom out and go all the way up. Look at the timestamp here. It's 1453 is where we started, and we go all the way down to the bottom. This is Eastern Daylight Time, 1538. So we've been collecting data here for almost an hour. If we re-execute the package, we should see more than 423 when we finish. We'll see the first one go through, and it's like flash. It should flash like 10 rows or something. And the second one should be greater than 423, and it's 432. So right now, the last time we executed this, we had 433 rows. Now we have 442. So we have 10 rows in that first one. And we can see that now we've got data all the way up to 1539. So kind of cool. It's working, staging our data. And it's actually letting us read. And because we are reading all of the files in there, we're accumulating this data, even though it is being truncated and reloaded in the table. All right, so what next? Well, we've got data and it's in a database. So having data in a file is cool and all, but having it in a database lets us do something. So our next, kind of our next piece here is to do something with this data. So we notice that if we scroll, it's kind of all over the place here, right? Interesting that we have that character here. So we'll, actually, I was going to say we'll leave that for right now, but we're not. Let's mess with that. Let's get rid of that. So can I copy that and detect that value? What if I say replace from the column, look for that value and replace it with an empty string? Let's see if that works. Hey, that worked. Okay, that was kind of junky, so we got rid of that. The next thing is this stuff at the end here, right? We've got what? 2, 3, 4, 5. What does it look like all the way to the end? Let's copy that. And then what if we wrap a replace around the replace? And we say replace that when we find this with an empty string. That's getting cleaner still, right? Kind of digging this. We've got some spots where we've got two spaces. I'm gonna go ahead and leave those in there because those make decent delimiters. Am I right? I'm right. All right. So that's kind of our source query, if we will. And what I want to do from that source query is I'm going to pick it apart. So I'll go ahead and name this query Q. That'll be my source query. And I want to select star from Q. And if I do that, of course, I get the same results here as I've been getting. I'm going to do, just to keep things a little cleaner, I'm going to do top 10 star. That's going to give me the data out of my first file. That keeps me up in the working window here. Keeps me from having to scroll. And next, I want to start parsing this data. So I'm going to say, give me the substring of Q, the column. And I think I want to do it this way. I always get substring syntax mixed up. I'll say start at 0 and go to the car index of Q column. Look for the pipe. Nothing. Not surprised. So let me start here. Zero. Interesting. Maybe it's zero search for it. No. Argument data type is invalid for argument 3. Maybe it's zero comma. I always have to figure this out. No, doesn't like you. Weird. Maybe these are backwards. Search for the pipe in the column. Start at 0. That's happy. Start at 1. Also happy. Let's go with 0. All right. 23 is the number. And I think it's kind of this. I think I boogered it up over here as well. Start at 0. Look in the column. Go to the index there. Show me that substring. Maybe it's this way. No. Wait a minute. This is wrong.
Let's tell it start at 0. Doesn't like that. Let's tell it start at 0. Go to that car index in the column. Still doesn't like it. Argument data type int is for argument 1. It doesn't like that. I gotta go look substring up. And I'll keep guessing until you all go away. Expression start length. Expression start. Maybe 1? This is a number. It's 23. That's that. I know that's right. Right? Let's double check. Copy. Oh, that's backwards. Idiot. There. Okay. So this is how I get my temperature string. Although, let's do, instead of 0, let's not look for pipe. Let's look for temperature colon space. And let's look for space, space pipe. And car index. Doesn't like it. Likes it. Look at there. Go. Close. Let's try that. There we go. We're missing a space. We got a space at the beginning here. No space at the end. Look at that. Okay, so we are substringing strings and we're getting a value. That is our temperature C. So the next thing I want is the temperature F. So for that one, I'm going to go to the car index. This is my beginning, and my stop is the word humidity. Car index. You are my beginning. And right now, I want to go space, space. Plus the length of that. This also becomes my len at the end here. And my subtractor, the car index of that. Now, is that right? Yeah, that's my beginning. Now, I want to go to the word humidity. And that is you. This one. Start here. Find humidity. Subtract the beginning of the pipe. Let's see if that works. Let's go back to a grid. Yep, there it is. Kind of cool. Okay, do we have spaces after that? I do want to go back to the text and check that. We do have a space after that. And the C. We'll manage that later. Okay, we've got Fahrenheit. We have Celsius. It looks like these next two are giving us different. I wonder what's going on with this. I wonder if we have a second temperature sensor out there. I guess I could check. Let's see. I'm going to zoom in here for a minute and see. It's odd that I'm seeing hitting decimals here. Something different here. I wonder if this is my heat index. Could be because of my humidity. So I definitely want to pull humidity, and I'm not sure about these other temperatures. And I do want to pull heat index, and I want the time. Do I want the measurement number? Maybe. I think I do. I might as well get those temperatures while I'm at it. Okay, back out. So next we want humidity. We want to start at humidity. That's our start. Our end is at the percent sign, maybe percent colon temperature. Let's just do temperature. Now this is going to be interesting. I want space temperature. Because I don't want to pick up that temperature at the very beginning. You know. That's what I'm after, I think. Temperature space. Temperature space is my end. I want to subtract the length of my end. I want to mark my end here. I know what worries me about this a little bit is I've got, that's right. Every new beginning is some other beginning's end. Yeah. Okay. And let's take this out to humidity PC 4%. Doesn't like it. Substrate humidity space. Space temperature. I wonder if that's it. I wonder if I need a percent sign in here. That may work. It may also go all regex on me. I'm not sure. I know regex works in like, so I see 0%. I've messed something up. Zero temperature 31. I'm missing this part. I want to start at humidity. Space humidity. I wonder if that's what's going on. I wonder if he's ignoring this. Let's try that. No. This should work. No, I think if I take this out, it's going to find the first one. And it's going to blow up. I think it's finding this temperature. Not the second one.